everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we are doing our October garden cleanup. This is for the vegetable gardens that we're working on today. It's time. We've had about three different frosts. The tomatoes had a strange ending to the year. They weren't quite ready, and then it rained, and then it was not nice, and then it got cold. And so a lot of the tomatoes were left hanging on the vines, either rotten or not done and in limbo. So we kind of ended things early without picking a whole bunch of them, especially the little cherry tomatoes. And so now it's a matter of cleaning all the tomatoes, every last orange speck and every last bit of vegetation out of these beds. Yes. You may hear a lot of lawnmowers in the background. That's because this has been the first nice day in about a week. So everybody knows they've got to get their grass cut. They got to get the leaves that have fallen up off their lawn. And today's the day to do it. So we'll try to make ourselves heard. Now this is a typical way that your garden will look after you've pulled out the plants and taken out the cages. There are tomatoes in here, there are weeds in here, there are leftover flowers. Usually I like to leave the marigolds because the nematodes that are attracted by those are wonderful ones. The sweet alyssum that I have put in here, while I would wish I could leave it in for the last of the pollinators that are out, it's gonna get in my way. So what I'm going to do now is just rake everything up. And you can see what's still attached. Those are weeds. They all have to go. Okay, so this will be going. This again is wood sorrel, and you can see those little pods on there. Those pods have hundreds of seeds in them. We have realized over the years that what we put in our compost, we rarely take out of our compost. So all of this, instead of going to the recycling center this year, are just going into our compost bins. And it's easier to put this in a bucket rather than rake it up and put it in the wheelbarrow and then have to lift it out of the wheelbarrow and put it in the compost.
Think of all the exercise you're getting today.
Mm-hmm. All is bending over.
Crunches. Lettuce.
Just waiting to blossom all over my garden. Oh, thank you. How many thousands of seeds could that have?
Quite a few.
Well, you get the idea. I have two beds that are clean. Woohoo! I have one, two, three, four more tomato beds to do. But there are other things that we have to do or I already have done. So come on, let's go see what those were. About a week ago when we had one nice day, we pulled out all of these things that we had over here, the patty pans, the butternuts, the watermelons, the grapes, all of the blackberries, some of the raspberries. Now, we know, we've experienced this before, they will be back. But at least we have a start, and it looks so much better. Now over here, we still have our Mexican sunflower up. Some of it was touched by frost. Some of it wasn't. That's the weird part about frost. But there was this one that I cut down, and I thought, with Halloween coming, this would be cool to put a sheet over, because the trick-or-treaters come right through here and up to get their treat at the front door. Oh, and here we had all of those Peruvian sun drops, and they were prolific. You can see how much space they took up by what's empty in here. And they had hundreds of seeds on them, and I'm thinking, oh no, if all of those were viable come spring, I would have nothing but Peruvian sunflowers. So they're gone, except for the seeds that fell. Now these are our big slabs that we had from the willow tree, and we had that one lying flat, and we decided we were gonna tip them up because we want them to dry equally on both sides. So we still have three more to roll, and my husband has already hurt his wrist doing this without asking for help. So we're gonna have to have help with those other three. Some of you may have seen what we do every fall. Some of you may have not. We ask our neighbors to leave their bagged leaves and grass clippings over here in this designated area, and then we use those as gold for our garden. It is just wonderful. It has nutrients in it. It develops a mold that is good for what you're trying to grow in your garden. It's a mulch, it's a fertilizer, it's you name it, what's in there is wonderful.
Think you'll get more today?
I think I'll get more today, and definitely more tomorrow before tomorrow night's rain. We'll have more. When you live in these colder climates with frost zones, you can plant bulbs, tender bulbs, in the beginning of summer and enjoy them all summer, like these elephant ears. But come fall, they have to be dug up and saved if you want to do it that way. And so while this group of elephant ears hasn't been touched too badly by the frost, my huge one right next to the house looks terrible. This just makes me sad. Now, you know, there's parts of fall that I enjoy, like the leaves and the smells and getting rid of some plants that I don't want. But these are always just so wonderful, and they get so tropical, and now they're done. So I will be digging this big clump out and letting it harden off a little bit. Then I'll cut back all the foliage, and once they're ready, they're going down into the basement where they'll spend the whole winter. Also in this climate, you have to take your hoses in. Who would think of it? You have to turn off the outside faucet, go down, turn it off in the basement, and then open the outside faucet and let the water run so that you know the pipes are empty and they won't freeze. We went with this kind of hose, this light metal hose. It's been 3 years now since we bought these.
Yeah, 3 years ago.
They're wonderful. They're light. You can lift 100 feet of hose with no problem. You can run over it with the car. I don't really think that's a good thing to do, but you could. You can step on them. They do not collapse. And look at that. So these will be going, after they're drained, they will be going on the back porch, and they'll rest up until next spring. Everything we have in the containers will also have to be dug up. These dahlias are all beautiful. I mean, this, look at the colors of that. I mean, it's just gorgeous colors, but look at this one. And the bees are still in there. They are enjoying these last flowers that are actually blooming, getting their last drink of nectar. So on days like this, any flower that they can find, is just a wonderful thing for them.
I notice you have clematis up there that is still blossoming.
There's still one up there blossoming, yes.
Now that all has to be cut back.
Yep, and see that
morning glories?
Yes, you can see those morning glory flowers that I planted 5 years ago, and they keep coming back. I hate to think about these. Those and these.
Well,
it's going to be interesting.
Yes, it will be, won't it, Tim?
We often talk about the monkshood and how we wait and wait until the end of the year for it to bloom. It is in its glory right now, and the bees are blessed. They're just in and out. You can see little butts. That's not a bee, but it's an insect that's enjoying. There's some bees over there. That was a honeybee.
They're all over.
Yep. But they call it monk's hood because, let me get one. It looks like a little monk with its hood up. These are poisonous, and some people can't even touch them. I am fortunate that so far they haven't bothered me, but they grow tall, and if you need a beautiful specimen plant in the back somewhere, this would be a great one. And again, they wait until the very, very end, and so you have color, and you have bee food, and all sorts of good stuff. Monk's hood. Now this was the most glorious, probably, of all of the arches, although that other one is pretty good. This is the cypress vine that had the neat leaves on it. I only hope that it won't come back until I plant it again. But it is so prolific. It's down on the ground, growing right over the cement. This one, I think, has been touched a little bit by the frost, but so far it hasn't killed it, as opposed to these morning glories, which definitely have been touched. And it'll be interesting trying to get them all off of here. I've done one so far.
How about the one in the back?
Yep. This is the Baptisia plant, or false indigo. And a friend of ours had a friend who had a bush and didn't know what it was. Well, this is what it looks like if you put a cage around it in the spring before it blooms. And then as it dies off, the leaves turn black like this. Come spring, you just bend these off. They'll come off very easily, and the new sprouts will come up from the ground. Very lovely bush. Nice purple flowers. Now this is our wooden archway. Believe it or not, there it is inside. And these are only morning glories. There's, I think, three different kinds up here. This side was later in starting, but it also seems to be the one most touched by the frost. This side, closer to the house and sheltered by this side, is not so badly frosted yet, but it will be. Some people have asked, well, what do you do with your waterfall in the winter? Well, we turn it off for one thing, and we take out some of the water in the lower bed because we know that this is going to be filled with snow as we shovel. The middle stays like that. The top we usually empty totally. Now, we had put an ad in our neighborhood watch listing for people that wanted to come and get some of the goldfish because they're not going to make it through the winter, and they're beautiful and they're pretty large. And one morning, a young man and his little boy, who was probably four maybe, came over, and the two of them went fishing, trying to catch fish. Well, the water was so deep that day that they couldn't get any, so Rick took the sump pump and started pumping out some of the water so they could get a better chance at taking some. And they did. They were very happy. The little boy was just all smiles. We still have some left. So if you're in our neighborhood and you want goldfish, come on over, bring a 5-gallon bucket. In addition to plants and fish, you have certain things that you're gonna bring in, like my little flamingo will be coming in, my little whirligigs will come in, and we'll empty Brian's bird bath here and bring that in so it doesn't crack with the frost that will certainly develop in there. And we have this aeroponic unit that, while we didn't use it yet this year, we didn't want it to get ruined by the winter, so we've got that wrapped up and topped off. And kind of looks like a pumpkin head. Should just put some eyes on here.
I think we need to turn it into a Green Bay Packer football helmet.
Well, that too, but it's the wrong color. Something that always makes me happy, though, is my picnic table. I no longer have to move it out of the driveway so we can shovel. It's here in its own backyard on its own little deck, and I can look out and see its little redness and know that if on a nice warm winter day, I could bring my lunch out here. Now, the lily pads in the big pond, waterfall pond, will just stay there and they will be fine. They'll come back next year like nothing has even happened. But these ones in the shallower part have to be moved into the bigger part so that they can survive for the winter. So I usually just put them in another bigger basket and set the whole basket in, and they will last in the winter under the snow and ice and be ready again next spring. Several of our viewers said they wish they could garden, but they can't bend over anymore. This is why Rick built this Liberty Garden for me, because we wanted to be able to show people that there are raised beds that you can use. You can buy them, you can make them, you can have somebody else that's very nice make them for you. This was full this summer, not only with seeds that we started indoors and then moved out here temporarily, but with asparagus and with just a variety of flowers that we just left here after we put them in and didn't want to move them anyplace else, and we just enjoyed them. I even grew peas up here on this side, and it was wonderful. I didn't have to bend over at all. And to weed, I just needed to put my arms down and dig around and clip things off. So this is a fantastic option for people that can't bend over. And I know they have littler ones. Our daughter has some up right up on her deck, so she doesn't have to go down steps to get to it. It's right there handy. Well, we're back where we started, and I don't know why, but those garden elves did not do a darn thing while we were gone walking around. So I still have four beds to work on, some carrots and some beets to pull out, but we also know we have visitors. These are deer droppings, and they were here visiting, and I'm glad I've got my my beets and my carrots behind wire so they can't get to them.
I did not do that.
I sure hope not. Be a good boy.
Thank you.
Go in the house. If you enjoyed this video, please give us a thumbs up. We really appreciate you watching and encouraging us and sending us good wishes. And if you have questions or comments that you'd like to send us, we'd love to hear from you. Also, if you'd like to become part of our garden family, remember, over there somewhere, there is this little orangey red button that you can tap to become a subscriber to us. Thanks again. Happy Halloween.
Connect with us on YouTube.